الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. There is no doubt that sitting in a circle of knowledge like this brings about a lot of benefits, a lot of reward. The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he spoke highly about circles of knowledge. And he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as it is collected by Imam Muslim in his Sahih on the authority of Abu Huraira radiyallahu an, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَجْتَمَعَ قَوْمٌ فِي بَيْتٍ بُيُوتِ اللَّهِ يَتْلُونَ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَيَتَدَارَسُونَهُ بَيْنَهُمْ إِلَّا نَزَلَتْ عَلَيْهُمُ السَّكِينَةُ وَغَشِيَتْهُمُ الرَّحْمَةُ وَحَفَّتْهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَذَكَرَهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي مَنْ عِنْدَهُ. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever a group of believers get together in one of the houses of Allah, al-masajid, reciting the book of Allah and studying it among themselves, except that serenity descend upon them and the mercy of Allah covers them and the angels surround them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions them among the high angels who are with him. It shows you the importance of al-ilm. العلم النافع, the beneficial knowledge. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم also said on the authority of Muawiyah ibn al-Hakam رضي الله عنه, Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, من يريد الله به خيرا يفقه في الدين. من يريد الله به خيرا يفقه في الدين. When Allah wish good for someone, He grant them the understanding of the religion. And we're studying, alhamdulillah, every Wednesday we take some benefit from the book of the senior scholar and elder Sheikh Salih bin Fawzan al-Fawzan, may Allah preserve him, which is Al-Mulakhas Al-Fiqhi, Summary of Islamic Jurisprudence. And this is a very simple book, very simple, alhamdulillah. The Sheikh, he did a very great, you know, good job, and he clarified al-fiqh from A to Z, alhamdulillah. And we have taken a lot of chapters when it comes to the salat. And now, inshallah ta'ala, tonight, we're going to speak about the zakat. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he said, dear Muslim brothers, a Muslim must know the details of the rulings on zakat. Its condition, those required to pay it, those for whom it is to be paid, and the properties from which it is to be paid. This is because zakat is one of the pillars of Islam, and its great basis, as clearly indicated by the noble Quran and the Sunnah, and the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah exalted be He has joined it with performing prayer in His book in 82 positions. SubhanAllah. So the Shaykh is saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala joined Salat wa Zakat in 82 positions of the Quran. 82 موضع في القرآن. La qarana bayna as-salati wa zakat. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala joined between salat and zakat in 82 positions in the Quran. Like for example, وَعَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ وَآتُ الزَّكَاةِ. Establish the salat and give the zakat. But how do you give the zakat? You have to go to the sunnah. Because the sunnah explains al-Quran. And it's impossible for us to understand al-ahkam, the rulings of the sharia, without the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِ. And we sent down to you this reminder, Al-Quran, so that you can clarify to the people what has been sent down to them. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He clarifies the affairs of the deen. He clarifies the affairs of the deen sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Shaykh said, which signifies its a great status, because if it is mentioned 82 times in the Quran coupled with the Salat, it shows you the great virtue and status of this pillar of Islam. Because zakat is one of the pillars of Islam. The Shaykh said, rahimahullah ta'ala, the great status and perfection of the connection between it and prayer, and the firmness of the relations between them, the trustworthy person of that nation, who was the first caliph after Allah's Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Bakr Siddiq, radiyallahu anhu, said, by Allah, I will fight those who differentiate between prayer and zakat. So he said that he will fight those who differentiate between salat and zakat. Allah exalted be He, says, and establish prayer and give zakat. Surah Al-Baqarah. And Allah exalted be He also says, but if they should repent, establish prayer and give zakat, let them go on their way. فَإِنْهُمْ أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةُ وَآتَوُوا الزَّكَاةُ فَخَلُّوا سَبِيلَهُمْ. The ulama, they have taken from this ayah that the one who does not pray is disbeliever. From this ayah right here. The one who does not pray is a disbeliever. From this ayah, another ayah. فَإِنْهُمْ أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةُ وَآتَوُوا الزَّكَاةُ فَإِخْوَانُكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ. مفهوم المخالفة أنهم إذا لم يقيموا الصلاة ولم يؤدوا الزكاة فليسوا بإخوان لنا في الدين. أليس كذلك؟ بلى. Now, the ulama, they have taken from this particular ayah, another ayah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if they, the mushrikeen, establish the salat and give the zakat, then leave them alone. Don't fight them. Another ayah, if they establish the salat and give the zakat, then they are your brethren in the religion. Your brethren, your brothers in the religion of Islam. So in other words, if they don't, would they be our brothers? They would not be. So that's why ulama, Shaykh al-Allama Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, has a risala, has a treatise about the one who does not pray. It's a very serious matter. And you find, subhanAllah, so many Muslims, they don't pray. And some of them, al-iyadu billah, they die, and then they never made one sajda to Allah, subhanAllah. Not even one sajda. This is a very serious affair. And some of them, they give zakat and they fast the month of Ramadan and they do everything else, but they don't pray. But they don't pray. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Al-ahdu alladhi baynana wa baynahum as-salat, faman tarakaha faqad kafar." He said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Al-ahdu alladhi baynana wa baynahum." The criterion that divides us and them means us Muslims and non-Muslims is the Salat. So whoever abandons it, who does not pray, then he is a disbeliever. Ulama al-Usul, they said, al-kufr ida utliqa kana kufran akbar. Ida utliqa kana kufran akbar. لأنه غير مقيد. مطلق. هكذا. يعني هناك المطلق وهناك المقيد. Okay, now you have that which is restricted and that which is unrestricted. So the word kufr is unrestricted. So it is what? Major kufr. Major kufr. Because he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَمَنْ تَرَكَهَا فَقَدْ كَفَرْ. Whoever forsakes it, then he has committed kufr al-akbar. Major kufr. So that shows you the danger of the one who does not pray. The one who does not pray. And Shaykh al-Allama Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen rahimahullah, he said if one of the spouses stops praying, like the woman or the man, they stop praying altogether, then what happened to the contract, barakallahu fikum? It gets nullified. Gets nullified. يُفْسَخُ عَقْدُ النِّكَاحِ. Now, so the nikah's contract becomes null void. Why? Because the one of the spouses, they stopped praying altogether. And this opinion seems to be stronger. And this is the opinion of Sheikh Abdul Aziz bin Abdullah bin Baz, Sheikh Abdullah bin Ghdiyan, rahimahullah, Sheikh Salih Muhammad al-Hidan, Sheikh Salih al-Fuzan, Sheikh Muhammad bin Salih al-Uthaymeen, and the Permanent Committee of Lifta. This is the opinion that is stronger. The Shaykh, he said, moreover, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Islam is based on the following five principles. To testify that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. There is no deity worthy. Pay attention to this statement. لا إله إلا الله نفي وإثبات. نفي وإثبات. لا يصح التوحيد إلا بالنفي والإثبات. التوحيد will not be valid unless a person, there is a negation and affirmation. لا إله إلا الله. There is no deity worthy of being worshipped. Except Allah. Except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because لا إله إلا الله has two pillars. Has two pillars. لها ركنين. Has two pillars. The first pillar, النفي. Second pillar, الإثبات. النفي والإثبات. Negation and affirmation. For example, when you say, there is no one in the house except Ahmed. There is no one in the house except Ahmed. You have singled out Ahmed to be the only one in the house. هذا توحيد في اللغة. This is توحيد in the linguistic sense. But in the legislative sense, بالمعنى الشرعي, هو إفراد الله بالعبادة. إفراد الله بالعبادة. To single out Allah in worship. Because at التوحيد, العلماء, they say there are three categories. The first one, توحيد الربوبية. وهو إفراد الله بأفعاله. بأفعاله سبحانك الخلق والإيجاد وما إلى ذلك. So you single out Allah in His action as the Lord. So He is the creator, He is the sustainer, He is the provider. He's the one that sends down the rain. He's the one that knows the unseen and so on and so forth. Al-Mushrikeen, they didn't have an issue with this one. وَلَا إِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَهُمْ لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهِ If you were to ask them who created them, they would surely say Allah. وَلَا إِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهِ If you were to ask them who created the heavens and earth, they would surely say Allah. That was not an issue with them. But the issue was in the second category of Tawheed. Which is Tawheed al-Uluhiyya or Tawheed al-Ibadah. The unity of worship. Like for example, a dua is one of the actions that is an act of worship. An act of worship that is to be directed only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some people, they call upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They call upon Sheikh Abdul Qadir al-Jailani. Ya Sheikh Abdul Qadir, aghitni. A'udhu billah min dhalik. So they call upon Sheikh Abdul Qadir, Ya Sheikh Abdul Qadir, help me out. Or Sayyid al-Badawi, or Sayyid Zainab, or al-Dusuqi, or other than them, from so-called al-Awliya. So when someone does this, wal-iyadu billah, this is shirk. It takes a person out of the fold of Islam, and this is shirk billah. You have joined partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by calling others beside Allah. By calling others beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the dua must be directed only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that is the first, you know, pillar of Islam. I testify that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. And that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah. The second, to perform the congregational prayer. And the reason he said congregational prayer, he's talking about the five daily prayers. And congregational means it is wajib to perform them in jama'ah, in congregation, for men. Not for the women, not for the traveler. Because if someone is traveling around here and there, it's not required upon them to pray in jama'ah, in the masjid. But if they happen to be in that particular area and there's a masjid, they should go to the masjid and pray with the Muslims. Likewise, the woman. The woman is not required to go to the masjid to pray in jama'ah because al-jama'ah is not obligatory upon her. Now, the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned the third pillar of al-Islam to pay zakat. Muslim scholars have unanimously agreed that zakat is obligatory, means there is ijma'. Ijma' al-ulama. There is unanimous agreement among the Muslim scholars that it is wajib, it is obligatory. If you wish, you can say fard. Fard or wajib or lazim. All that is the same. The Sheikh said, as it is the third pillar of Islam, the third pillar of Islam, and he who denies this is considered a disbeliever. If someone denies zakat, جحدها والعياذ بالله يكفر. العلماء say, من أنكر ما هو معلوم من الدين بالضرورة يكفر. Anyone who denies anything that is known by necessity from the religion of Islam, like what? Something that is known by necessity, like what? From the deen of Islam.
Fasting.
Fasting, ahsant. Fasting the month of Ramadan. Fasting the month of Ramadan. 5 daily prayers. Al-Hajj. So anyone who denies anything that is min al-daruriyat. Daruriyat. So these matters, if someone denies any of them, wal-iyadu billah, if there is no barrier, there is no, ليس هناك مانع. المانع كالجهل. If someone was, for example, was ignorant, he lived in an environment where the people, there are people of tasawwuf. Because these people of tasawwuf, والعياذ بالله, they are deviated. يقولون مثلا, نحن لا يلزمنا أن نصلي أو نزكي أو كذا لأننا قد وصلنا. وصلنا. You know, these people, they're deviant. They say, we don't have to pray. Prayer is for the beginners. Because we have reached the peak. We have reached the peak. So we don't need to pray. We don't need to fast. We don't need to do anything. Why? Because of their misunderstanding of the text. Misunderstanding of the text. لأنهم يفهمون النصوص خطأ. فمثلا قوله تعالى واعبد ربك حتى يأتيك اليقين. And worship your Lord until اليقين comes to you. Okay, the word يقين, what does it mean? اليقين. What does it mean here? الموت. 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 Death. Until you die, basically. Worship Allah until you die. But al-yaqeen also can mean what? Certainty. Al-yaqeen la yuzalu bil-shak. Al-yaqeen la yuzalu bil-shak. Certainty cannot be nullified with doubt. Like for example, if someone had waswas and had doubt that he doesn't have wudu, but he already made wudu, does he have to go back and make wudu or he doesn't have to? He doesn't have to. لأن الأصل بقاء ما كان على ما كان. بقاء ما كان على ما كان حتى يأتي دليل على غير ذلك. Because the origin that this man is in a state of tahara until we have an evidence that says otherwise. And likewise, if someone had a doubt whether he divorced his wife or he did not divorce his wife, we say الأصل أنك متزوج. They say with the origin that you are married. And there is no proof and evidence that you have divorced her. وَالْيَقِينَ لَا يُزَلُ بِالشَّكِّ. Certainty cannot be nullified with doubt. So al-yaqeen in the ayah means al-maut. So as-sufiya, look how the shaytan, wal-iyadu billah, deceived them. They said, نَعْبُدُ اللَّهِ حَتَّى يَأْتِينَ الْيَقِينَ. We worship Allah until we become certain. So when it becomes certain, we don't have to worship Allah. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ ضَلَال. وَلِذَلِكْ ذَكَرَ الْإِمَامُ الْأَصْبَهَانِ فِي كِتَابِهِ حِلْيَةِ الْأَوْلِيَاءِ. حِلْيَةِ الْأَوْلِيَاءِ ذكر أن هناك أحد كبار الصوفية لكنه كان عاقلا. لكنه كان عاقلا. وقد جاءه ناس فقالوا له إن هناك أناس يزعمون أنهم قد وصلوا. فقال نعم وصلوا إلى سقر. وصلوا إلى سقر، لأنهم يقولون الآن خلاص وصلنا فلا نحتاج إلى صلاة ولا زكاة ولا، هذه للمبتدئين للمبتدئين، نعوذ بالله من ذلك. So one of the Sufi leaders, Abu Nu'aym al-Asbahani rahimahullah, this is a scholar of hadith, and also he writes biographies of the scholars and the like. In his book, Hilyat al-Awliya, it's a book, he speaks about al-Awliya. And he mentioned that one of the leaders of Tasawwuf, people came to him, and they told him, there are some folks out there, they claim that they have reached the peak, so they don't need to pray, they don't need to fast, they don't need to do anything. He said, yes, they have reached the peak of Jahannam. They have reached the peak of the hellfire. Now, Abu Nu'aym rahimahullah, he mentioned this in his book, Hilyat al-Awliya. The Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, the one who denies it is considered a disbeliever, and whoever refrains from giving it is to be fought. So, like, if we have a Muslim government, we have a leader, we're ruling by the Sharia and everything, and someone refused to give zakat, then he is to be fought until he gives the zakat. Because Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he fought those who refused to give the zakat. Zakat was enjoined in the second year of Hijrah. The second year of Hijrah. As you notice here, al-ahkam were not enjoined in Mecca. Right or wrong? So what was enjoined in Mecca? In Mecca, the zakat was enjoined in the second year of Hijrah. Right? Second year of Hijrah. What was enjoined in Mecca? What did Allah command the believers to do in Mecca? What was revealed? Like what was revealed? Like the ayat, the surah that were revealed. They have to do with what? Huh? Tawheed. Tawheed. The foundation. الأساس. لأن لا يصح الإسلام بدون أساس. ما يمكن. ولذلك العلماء يقولون الأساس ما يبنى عليه غيره، ما يبنى عليه غيره. The foundation is that which other than it is built upon it. ولذلك يقولون أغصان الشجرة تبنى على الأصل، تبنى على الأصل، أصل الشجرة وهو الجدار، يعني الجذع الشجرة، جذع الشجرة. Now the trunk of the tree, because the tree has a trunk, and then has branches. The branches, if it was not for the trunk, it would be no branches. لأنه إذا بطل الأصل بطل الفرع. If the foundation is destroyed, then the branches are destroyed as well. نعم. So if there is a foundation, inshallah, there will be branches, and from the branches the fruits will come out. The fruits will come out. أي نعم. So when the Muslims were in Mecca, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He enjoined upon them to be patient. And also the ayat al-tawheed. The ayat of tawheed. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was teaching the Muslims to be patient and also al-tawheed. Because the society was upon shirk. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the ayat that talks about tawheed, talks about the day of the judgment. Very stern ayat. But when the Prophet ﷺ migrated to Al-Madinah, then al-ahkam, the rulings, what to do, what not to do, and the like zakat. The Shaykh said it was enjoined in the second year of Al-Hijrah. السنة الثانية من الهجرة. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم immigration to Al-Madinah. Allah's Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم sent zakat collectors to receive it in order to deliver it to those who deserve it. The same was done by the rightly guided caliphs and Muslims after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Paying zakat is an act of benevolence towards the people, a means of purifying the property from defilement, and a protection against destruction, and a worship of the Lord. Exalted be He, Allah exalted be He, says, take, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from their wealth a charity by which you purify them and cause them increase, and invoke Allah's blessing upon them. Indeed, your invocations are reassurance for them, and Allah is hearing and knowing. Surah At-Tawbah. Hence, it purifies the souls from stinginess. So if you want to be generous, you give zakat. Because when you give fi sabilillah, you purify your soul from what? Al-bukhl wal-iyadu billah. Wa ma adraka ma al-bukhl. Stinginess. And that's why those who are stingy, they don't give. And they don't like to give, wal-iyadu billah. They don't even give to themselves. Na'udhu billah min dalik. You find a stingy person, he does not even take care of himself. Let alone he's going to take care of his wife and his kids and all that. And the rest of the society, wal-iyadu billah. And that's why Ibn al-Jawzi, rahimahullah, he mentioned that there was a woman, she loved money so much, so wal-iyadu billah, that when she was dying, she did not want to leave anything for the heirs, al-warata. بنعت المال كله والعياذ بالله. She swallowed all the money. نعوذ بالله من ذلك. Subhanallah, the person is going to get to this extreme where they're going to swallow the money because she did not want to leave anything for the heirs. والعياذ بالله. صلى الله السلام والعافية. It shows you the danger of stinginess. When someone is stingy, والعياذ بالله, the soul is stingy too. Because if the soul نفسه والعياذ بالله بخيلة والعياذ بالله, the soul of that person is stingy, of course he's going to be stingy as well. But subhanallah, when someone gives fi sabilillah, Allah increases their wealth, Allah blesses their wealth, Allah purifies their soul, purifies their wealth, Allah gives them from where they don't expect, subhanallah. And the Shaykh, he said, and it is also a trial to the rich person, since he approaches Allah by giving some of his property that he likes. And it is also a trial for the rich person because, you know, he loves this money. And for him to give, it's a test for him too. It's a test. Some people they have, but they don't give. A'udhu billah. Some of them, wal-iyadu billah, they don't even give to their own mother, their own father, the brothers and sisters. And some of them, wal-iyadu billah, you hear that his brother or sisters, they're suffering, struggling, and he does not give them anything. Wal-iyadu billah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam al-afiyah. A'udhu billah min dalik. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us from that, you know. Subhanallah. You know, animals, they take care of each other. What about human beings? Subhanallah. Human beings, we should have compassion towards one another. Because you never know. You never know. You could become homeless anytime. Allah takes away all the wealth that you have. Then what's going to happen? The person that you were taking care of is going to say, you know what, this brother right here, it was very good to me. I'm going to take care of him. You see? But you don't give him anything, you didn't give him anything. He said, you never gave me anything. You were so stingy. You know? But subhanallah. That's what Prophet ﷺ, he said. Sana'u al-ma'roof taqi masari' al-su'. Subhanallah. Sana'u al-ma'roof taqi masari' al-su'. When you do good things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saves you through those good deeds from calamities. I'm going to share with you this story, and then we will end here, inshallah, because the time is up. There was a family traveling. So the wife and her husband and the kids. So they were traveling, and there was a lady on the side of the road, very poor lady. She was in a very bad state. So the wife told the husband to stop the car. So the husband, he was kind of reluctant, a little bit reluctant. He didn't want to stop the car. She said, please, stop the car. Alhamdulillah, finally he stopped the car. She walked up to this woman and she said, ma'am, how can I help you? So she found out that the woman was in bad condition. So she gave her sadaqah. So she went back into the car. And then they began to travel again. And suddenly the husband, he fell asleep. Can you believe that? Someone fall asleep over the wheel. That's very dangerous. For a few seconds, he fell asleep. Then there was a ring. Somebody called his phone. And he woke up. And then he starts saying, Allahu Akbar, means Allah saved us. Alhamdulillah. Then the wife, she said, why are you saying Allahu Akbar? He said, well, we were going to die. All of us were going to die. Allah saved us through this ring from this phone. So when he looked at his phone, it was his wife's number. So he was wondering, where is your phone? And then the phone started ringing again. So it was that woman on the side of the road. She said, sir, your wife left her phone with me. Can you come and pick it up? But look, subhanallah, sana'i al-ma'roof, taqi masari' al-su'. Because they did a good deed. They gave sadaqah fi sabilillah to that woman, subhanallah. Look how Allah took care of them. He saved them from death, from dying in an accident. So he went back and they picked up their phone. Subhanallah. Look at this. So if your heart is hard, replace it with a rock. إذا كان قلبك قاسي فاستبدله بالحجارة. هذا الذي يناسب، هذا الذي يكون قاسي القلب والعياذ بالله. سأل الله السلام والعافية. أسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يجعلنا من أوليائه المقربين مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين، إنه ولي ذلك والقادر عليه. صلى الله على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم.